In part 4 of our lesson on vectors, you will learn how to determine the magnitude of a resultant force. Now, before we begin that lesson, let's do a quick geometry review about parallelograms. So I've drawn a parallelogram for you here, parallelogram MATH. And in a parallelogram, the opposite sides are equal to each other. So let's mark that in this picture. We know that side MH would equal side AT. We also know that side MA would equal side HT. We also know that the opposite sides are parallel to each other. So that means that side MH is going to be parallel to side AT, and side MA is going to be parallel to side HT. That's how we indicate it. We use one set of chevrons to show these two are parallel, and a double chevron to show those two are parallel. The opposite angles in a parallelogram are equal to each other. So angle M will equal angle T, and angle H will equal angle A. The consecutive angles in a parallelogram are supplementary. So consecutive angles are the angles that are not opposite angles. So they're right next to each other, meaning as you go around the parallelogram, the angles that are one right after the other. So angle M and angle A are consecutive angles, and so they would be supplementary. So angle M plus angle A would equal 180. Going around, angle A plus angle T will equal 180 because they are also supplementary. Continuing around, angle T plus angle H and that will equal 180. And finally, angle H plus angle M will equal 180. So all four sets of consecutive angles are supplementary. And lastly, the two diagonals of the parallelogram each divide the parallelogram into two congruent triangles. So if we were to draw in diagonal MT, then that would mean triangle MTH and TMA are congruent to each other. If we were to draw in diagonal HA, then that would mean triangle MHA is congruent to triangle TAH. One thing to be very careful of is to note that the diagonals do not bisect the angles in the parallelogram. Only in a very special case when you have a square does that happen. So in general, you cannot assume that the diagonal will bisect the angle. Does not happen. Okay, I just wanted to help you get all of those facts about parallelograms kind of back into the forefront of your mind. And now we can move on to the trigonometry of studying what a resultant force is. So a resultant force occurs when two forces act upon the same point. They sum together to make the point move in the direction and magnitude of the resultant force. So I think the best way to explore this is to work through an example together. In this example, two forces act upon a point. So here's the point being acted upon. Here's one of the forces. Here's the other force. So this force is pulling in this direction. This force is pulling in this direction. Now, because this arrow is shorter than this arrow, we know that this force is going to be smaller than this force. Remember that the length of a vector is its magnitude. So a shorter vector means a force of smaller magnitude, and a longer vector means a force of larger magnitude. So we are told that one of the forces is 57 newtons and the other is 83 newtons. So that makes sense in our picture. The shorter one will be 57, the longer one will be 83. The angle between the forces is 49 degrees, so this angle here is 49 degrees. We have to find the magnitude of the resultant force and the angle formed between the resultant force and the 57 newton force. Now, what happens when two forces act upon a point? Those two forces will add together. So what we're going to be doing here is adding two vectors. And we just learned two methods to find the sum of two vectors. If you remember, the first method, we had to put the vectors head to tail. That's not what's happening here. What's happening here is that both vectors have their initial point together. So clearly, we are using the second method where we have to create a parallelogram. So let's go ahead and do that now. We'll make dotted lines. We know opposite the 83 newton force, we'll make a dotted line that's parallel to it and equal in length. And opposite the 57 newton force, we'll do the same thing, parallel and the same length. Now we know that the resultant force starts at the initial point and is the diagonal of that parallelogram that we just made. So this is our resultant force, R. That diagonal will divide the parallelogram into two congruent triangles. So these triangles are congruent and we can work on either one. We know this side is 57. Then we would know that this side is 83. Now, one thing to be very careful of is we don't yet have an angle in our triangle. This 49 degrees is not in either triangle. The 49 degrees gives us the measure between the two forces. But that 49 degrees can help us find one of the angles in the triangle because we can use the rule that says that consecutive angles of a parallelogram are supplementary. So let's jot that down. Consecutive angles in a parallelogram, you can use a little symbol for parallelogram, are supplementary. Now, because that's true, we can do 180 minus 49 degrees. We find out that that is 131 degrees, and that will be this angle, which is in our triangle. So the 49 degrees and this angle of the parallelogram were consecutive angles, which meant that they had to be supplementary. So subtracting 49 from 180 degrees gave us 131 degrees, which gives us an angle in our triangle now. analyzing our triangle now, we see that we have side, angle, side. And any time you have side, angle, side, you know that means you can use the law of cosines. So we're going to be able to find the magnitude of our resultant. Remember now, vector r is the name of this vector. If I want to talk about the number that represents its length, then let's change this to magnitude of vector r. Now, using law of cosines, we know then that the magnitude of vector r squared will equal 57 squared plus 83 squared minus 2 times 57 times 83 times the cosine of the angle between them, which is 131 degrees. So now the magnitude of r, then, this was squared before, so now I'm going to have to take the square root of all of this. If we add together 57 squared plus 83 squared, we get 10,138 minus, and if we take 2 times 57 times 83, we get 9,462, and that's multiplying the cosine of 131 degrees. So then the magnitude of vector r is going to equal, we'll have to hit second, square root, 10,138 minus 9,462 times the cosine of 131. Now remember to close the parenthesis of the cosine and then close the parenthesis of the radical, enter, and rounding to the tenths place, we see that the magnitude of r is going to be 127.9. Now the units of r will be the same as the units of the other forces, and they were in newtons. And you can abbreviate newtons with NT. So the magnitude of the resultant force is 127.9 newtons. Now we are also being asked to find the angle formed between the resultant and the 57 newton force. So we have to find this angle right here. And just a quick reminder, the diagonal of a parallelogram does not bisect this angle, so you can't just take half of 49. That won't work. The only time that happens is in a very special parallelogram, which is a square. So as a general rule, the diagonal does not bisect the angle. So maybe we should call this theta. But now that we have the magnitude of r, we can label that in our triangle, 127.9. We see that our triangle has an obtuse angle in it, which means theta, as well as this other angle over here, have to be acute. So we can now use the law of sines to find theta. And we know it must be acute. So we can say then that the sine of theta divided by its opposite side, which is 83, has to equal the sine of 131 degrees divided by its opposite side, which is 127.9. Solving for the sine of theta, we would get 83 times the sine of 131 degrees divided by 127.9. Now we can go ahead and enter this into our calculators. So 83 times the sine of 131, close parenthesis, divide by 127.9, enter. This number is 0.4897, etc. Let's go ahead and store that into a memory location, say A. So we'll hit store and enter. Then we know we have to find the sine inverse of the sine of theta. And that is going to equal taking the sine inverse of this number that we just stored in memory location A, the 0.4897, etc. So now we will get theta is equal to, we have to do second sine inverse, memory variable, cursor under the A, hit enter, close your parenthesis, and hit enter. And we find out that rounded to the tenths place, theta is going to be 29.3 degrees. And that is the angle between the resultant and the 57 Newton force.